What is the difference between normalization and denormalization? Hello friends, today we'll see what is the difference between normalization and denormalization. Then we'll see how these techniques fit within an organization, how OLTP, Online Transaction Processing Databases, and how OLAP, Online Analytic Processing Databases, fit into an enterprise, what kind of purpose they serve, why we need both normalization, denormalization, why we need online transactional processing databases and OLAP, online analytic processing databases. We'll dive deeply into the techniques of normalizations and denormalization. So let's first discuss what are the big differences between normalization and denormalization. Normalization is about removing inconsistency and making sure that we don't have redundancy
in database.
Why we need to remove the inconsistency and redundancy? Suppose we have got an online order on the mobile phone, and as an organization, this order should be clear what customer wants, how much money he wants, and we should be able to execute that. There should not be any inconsistency in the database. Whereas the purpose of denormalization is to improve the performance of the query to make sure we get results faster from the database. Generally, denormalization is used for the databases, which are used for executives to run some fast report. So a executive of multinational wants to know what are the sales number for different countries, different regions, different states. So he should be able to get that report very fast. And that's where denormalization comes, which is opposite of normalization. In denormalization, you create duplicate data, you aggregate data. There is a lot of duplication of the data. That's another big difference between normalization and denormalization is. Normalization is used mainly for online transaction processing systems, OLTP systems, whereas denormalization is more used for decision support systems, business intelligence tools, and also OLAP, online analytic processing databases. Generally, you would have very less indexes on OLTP databases because if you have too many indexes, that slows down the insert, update, delete processing, whereas OLAP system, where retrieval of the data is very, very important, you will have a lot more indexes. That's another reason why we create this separation. Let's see how normalization and denormalization, also OLTP and OLAP, fits within an organization. So when you get an order, generally it goes to some transaction databases. There may be multiple transaction databases. Sales department may have its own transaction database. HR, human resources, may have their own databases. Inventory department may have their own databases. So finally, there are some ETL processes, extract, transform, and load processes, which we may be loading this data from these transaction databases and depositing into some central warehouse. This central warehouse may have all the data elements related to an organization. And then you have staging databases where you will be loading data from these data warehouses to the staging hospitals, staging databases. From these staging databases, data is loaded from staging to the MOT. Data will be aggregated. There will be a lot of duplicate data. You may have sales number for country level, state level, city level. So you will create a lot of aggregates of the data to make sure that executives can get the report fast so that they can take some quick decisions, see how their sales is doing, which regions are lacking behind, and take some action to increase the sales. So let's deep dive into normalization. Normalization is a technique of organizing data into table in the database. It's a systematic approach of removing duplication and inconsistency. So let's say we have a data, a denormalized data. We have students, we have their country information, countries, what are the courses they are taking, is this course is online or not, and are these courses online or instructor based, what is how many classes students have taken, what is the rate of per class, and what is the total amount. So what are the problems with this database? The first thing is that there's a problem with insert. We cannot add student unless he's enrolled in some course. Second problem is with update. Second problem is with update. Suppose we are changing computer course to some advanced computer course. We have to make sure we update all the records. Then delete. If we remove English courses, we'll lose students' information also. Also vice versa, if we will remove students, we'll also lose all the courses information. So here comes the normalization. The database is said to be in first normalized forms when there are all columns have unit values. So courses format, we have online or instructor. We have to make sure that each column should be atomic. What does that mean? So let's see course format. It has online, instructor based. So we have to make sure it should contain only one value. Either it should be online or atomic. So we need to have multiple rows. The second thing is order of the column should not matter, and each value in column should be specific to one domain. So if you are having courses name, it should be only course name. You should not put teacher name in course name. Let's come to second form. The database is second normal form if there are no partial dependencies. What does that mean? That all the columns should depend on the primary key. So courses have no dependency on the student. They should be in their tables. So we have to make sure that we design all the tables in that form. So what is the third normalization form? Database is in third normalization form if it is already in second normalization form and it has no transitive dependency. What it means? What does that mean? It means the column should change only if there's a change related to primary key. If your column is changing because of change in some other column, it should be moved to another database. So like course format, it can be online or instructor based. If it is based on the course being provided, if we say, let's say the computer course, it has to be instructor based. It has to be classroom based. So this is a transitive dependency. We need to move this column to its own table. The course format can be moved to its own table. So now, and another thing is if any column can be calculated, that should be removed. Some column can be calculated, for example, amount to be charged. Amount to be charged is just number of classes and rate of per one class. Amount of charges can be calculated by number of the classes student has taken and what is the rate of each class. So we can remove it from the database. So normalization is so great. Why we would go for denormalization? Why will we create duplication? As we already discussed, we need denormalization to improve the performance of the queries. So in denormalized, we'll be creating some high-level tables, maybe country, student, country, number of students, amount collected. So we may create these tables at different levels. So friends, thank you. And as we discussed, denormalized databases will have a lot of indexes. Thank you very much, friends, for watching this video. Today we discussed what is the difference between normalization and denormalization of database. If you like this video, like it, share it, and subscribe to my channel for your regular updates. Also connect with me on LinkedIn and Twitter, especially LinkedIn if you like small summaries of the video. I will be posting a lot of small summaries of the video on LinkedIn. Thanks again.